Normally I'm not very nervous about giving lectures, but there's so many of you have turned out here. And I'm terribly nervous I could disappoint you or the lecture could be boring or something like that. I'm first of all standing only. Standing is good in a soccer stadium, but standing is really bad for a lecture. Could you not? I mean, if you sit here in front, for example, I would feel very popular. I would feel surrounded by the people. I don't know. Many thanks for coming. I'm really moved, and thanks for the invitation to come to Kyiv. I've told the young colleagues who spent the afternoon with me doing many interviews and conversations. I told them something that I'm obliged to say, so it could be a lie, but I swear by the health of my grandchildren, it is true. I love to come to your country, and I love to come to Kyiv. There is a certain sympathy in the Greek sense of the word. There's a kind of shared emotion that I feel when I come here. It is probably very inappropriate, but I'm by training what you call in German a Romanist, a specialist of Romance languages, Romance countries. So my normal favorite countries in Europe are countries like Italy, Spain, Portugal, and so forth. And I feel a certain Eastern similarity of those countries. I feel like I'm in a Mediterranean mood when I come to Ukraine. The first city I got to know was Kharkiv, and I will never forget that, to Odessa, and now especially also to Kyiv. So I'm very, very happy to be here. And whatever you think about the lecture at the end, I want to assure you that it enormously matters to me that that be a good lecture and that this be a good intellectual event for you. Now, what this will be specifically all about is the question whether my work as a cultural historian, as a cultural philosopher, can have some political relevance. I'm neither a politician nor a political scientist, but the question is there something in that work that could be politically relevant? I will not talk much about politics, but the way I'm presenting what I'm presenting, and I'm basically referring to two books. One book is this After 1945, Latency as Origin of the Present. That is forthcoming in a Russian edition at NLO and in a Polish edition at Politskaya. And to another book that's called Our Broad Presence, that exists in a couple of languages, but I don't think in any Eastern European language. Now, this lecture then, and that should be your mood of reception, is an invitation to accompany me, to go along with me, in a relatively abstract and complex reflection. I mean, this is not an easy lecture. I mean, yesterday at Warsaw, I was giving a similar lecture, and people said it's complicated, but it's transparent. I was very happy about that. So I'm not saying fasten your seatbelts, but it's not going to be an easy lecture, and this is why I feel so embarrassed that some people are standing. I also take into account that, and I'm proud to say that, I know that in the Ukraine, some of you may have read some of my, I hate to say my work, some of my stuff, some of my publications. But some of you also have not. For some of you, this will be an introductory thing. So I hope that the optimism of inviting me and of thinking that this could be an interesting evening was not too optimistic. Once again, I'll be really do my very best to make this a worthwhile. And also, I think academic lectures should be entertaining, a worthwhile and an entertaining evening. At the beginning of a lecture, one should say how long it's going to be, and that is very difficult for me because, as some of you know, I always speak from notes. And if you speak from notes, it can get short, it can get long. That depends very much on the faces. So if you look at me like you're very interested, or even passionate, that turns me on, and I start telling anecdotes, and it can get terribly long. If you look at me with glacial, icy faces, then I'm embarrassed and I will skip things and it will be short. So what I can say, whatever happens, whether it's long or short, the responsibility will be completely yours. It's always your fault. If it's too short, it's your fault. If it's too long, it's your fault. I also like to say, but this is almost impossible with such a large audience, I try to be very deductive. So I develop things step by step. So if you feel that there's one step you really didn't get, you really didn't follow, then if you find it's necessary, do interrupt me. I mean, I prefer to develop something that remains clear and not develop the entire thing. do interrupt me not trying to clarify this question. I mean, yesterday at Warsaw, this was a smaller audience of 60 people, but some people did that, and this made the lecture really better. Now, my opening is that in recent times, not only in the Ukraine, there have been a number of observations and reasons to think that perhaps politics, the way we use this concept, and also history, the way we use these concepts in our classical understanding, have disappeared, have vanished. And when I'm saying that history, capital H, and politics, capital P, do you understand me? I mean, do you follow the English? And my voice is also carrying back there. I mean by history the implication that time is a necessary agent of change, that there are no phenomena that can resist transformation in time. And I mean, secondly, when I say history, capital H, that because things changes, there is at any given moment an open future. We know that things will be different in the future, but we do not know how they will be different. And thirdly, the concept of history implies that it should be possible to extract certain regularities from historical transformation so that you can project into the future, that there is a certain prognostic power in the observation of the past. I mean, I think these three implications are always there when we say history. When we say history in the everyday language, when we say history at the university. And that makes it clear how the concept of history is related to the concept of politics. Because I think the classical concept of politics, as it emerged and was shaped in the 18th century, implies that it is possible to shape the future from the present, that it is possible to have an impact on the future, more optimistically even, that it is possible to choose the future. I mean, this is what Marxism was based upon, this was what the superiority claim of Marxism was based upon, but this is still what at least the left believes is possible today. And you see how the two concepts are related. I mean, if there is no history in the classical sense, if there is no steady transformation and thereby an open future that we can somehow prognosticate, then there's also no politics. Is that clear? So you could say if history in a certain way has vanished, has disappeared, I intentionally don't say has come to an end, then there is no possibility for politics. Okay, let me give you some examples that make me think that maybe politics and history have disappeared in a sense. I make a long story short about history. I think all of us intellectuals, people who try to think in the global world, doesn't mean the entire world, have become much more skeptical, much more pessimistic about prognostics in any sense. Yeah, to say this will be the future because we have observed certain regularities in the past is not something you easily say today. I mean, some people still say it, but we are endlessly more skeptical than, let's say, in 1968, when I was 20 years old, the member of the Socialist Student Union of Germany, for example. Then, of course, we believe we can prognosticate, we can extrapolate the future very easily. Now, about the end of politics, let me give you a couple of examples too. My first example is my president, the president of my country, the president of the United States. I mean, if you remember this great enthusiasm around Barack Obama in the first election campaign for the presidency in the US in 2008, this was based on one basic slogan, and the slogan was, yes, we can. Yes, we can. Now, what did yes, we can mean? It meant that despite certain skepticisms and doubts, it is possible to shape the future. It is possible to have an impact on the future. It is possible to have programmatic politics. I personally, being a US citizen, believe that Obama has been a very good president, but there has been a disappointment and disillusionment because, and this became clear in the second electoral campaign that Obama won easily, he had become a crisis manager. I mean, there are no programmatic visions around Obama anymore. Obama is very good, at least for internal politics in the US, on day-to-day business. I mean, he keeps the country afloat. The economy is much better. I think the international image of the US has slightly improved after the Bush years. It couldn't get any worse. But there is no programmatic politics. There is no yes, we can. And that is disappointing. At the same time, the politicians who are appreciated today are politicians, you could express that paradoxically, who programmatically have no program, are politicians who react to the future when the future is becoming present. And I think the champion of that is Angela Merkel. I mean, Angela Merkel's program is to have absolutely no program. I'm not a great admirer of Angela Merkel. I also don't hate her because I'm not in the EU. So, I mean, I'm American, that's far away. But Angela Merkel is an unbelievably successful politician. I was reading today in the today's edition of the Frankfurter Allgemeine, the leading journal in, a daily journal in Germany, was saying there's one condition for German politics today, and this is that Angela Merkel will be chancellor as long as she wants. Yeah, whatever you talk about politics, you have to presuppose that her party is to win the elections. I mean, the difference between the Christian Democrats, her party, the Social Democrats today is more than 20%. And it used to be 5% or something like that. So it's unbelievably successful, and people think this is what politics should be today. But it is not politics old style. It has no program. It has no connection, so to speak, to the future. It always lives in a broad present. Let me point to some other events that make me think that politics in the old style is no longer politics today. I want to refer to Maidan. Maidan, and I will talk a little bit more about Maidan later, not much because it's ridiculous that I talk at Maidan, about Maidan at Kyiv. I mean, what do I know compared to you? But what I find interesting about Maidan was the impossibility to extrapolate a political will. Yeah, there was a manifestation, there was a collective body of people assembled, there was a very strong presence, but it turned out to be impossible to say, this is what Maidan means, this is where Maidan want to go. And maybe the problem, the missed opportunity of Maidan was precisely that people tried to interpret it the old style. So there has to be a one and only will of where Maidan wants to go. And there are similar events. There are similar events. I think the Arabic Spring was the same type of event, or the Arabic Springs in plural, one would have to say. So there were manifestations, but to try and say they were pro-Islamic or anti-Islamic, or they were this and that, or they had that program for the future was impossible. And for me, the most blatant case, because that is a country that I know relatively well, some of you may remember that from the newspapers, from the media, were the youth protests in Brazil the year before the Soccer World Cup, in 2013, during the Confederations Cup. So in all big Brazilian cities, and I happened to be in Rio while it happened, there were big youth manifestations. And the government got very, very nervous, and then Dilma, the Brazilian president, tried to negotiate with the students. The problem was, she didn't really know what the students wanted. Yeah? And then because they had to say something with the president, the representatives of the students assembled in Rio, São Paulo, Belo Horizonte, said it was about bus fares. Now then they negotiated, the bus fares were 20 centavos too high. I mean, 20 centavos is about 10 cents in American currency. Brazil is a wealthy country today. That was not the problem. You get my point. There are these manifestations. They are very, very powerful. But there is no way to extrapolate into the future. So after giving you some examples, let me say that the strong thesis of my talk today is as follows. Normally as an intellectual, you say, well, some people talk about the end of history, some people tend to talk about the end of politics, but really Fukuyama was stupid, and that was, and I'm not a great admirer of Fukuyama, and we are at the same university, and my end of history is different from Fukuyama's, but thereby, no, history is still there, don't things change, and politics is still there, don't we have parliaments, and so forth. No, I'm not going to do this. Most of my talk, and it will last about an hour, is to develop in detail and with careful philosophical arguments why I believe that we have reached an end of history, and it means something completely different than what Fukuyama means. And why I therefore believe, given how history, capital age, and politics are connected, that we also don't live in the classical age of politics anymore. But this does not make me say, and therefore we cannot do anything. The question is rather, what substitution or what different style of dealing with the past and doing what we used to call politics do we have for the future? I have no recipe for Maidan, but for example, the question is the helplessness, the national and international helplessness in confrontation with such an event. So this is where I want to go. And I will not give you solutions. I'm not a political scientist. I'm not a politician above all. But at least I will try to get by the end of a talk to a situation where we have a basis to seriously discuss the question, how to react to something like Maidan, to something like the Arab Spring, to something like our best politicians becoming, unfortunately, crisis managers. Now, how will I tackle this problem? My basic thesis is that what we used to take as natural, namely historical time or history, capital H, is not natural, but is much more subject to historical change. So my basic point will be to historicize the concept of history. And in doing that, I'm using a concept, the French call that the historical character of history, the French call that régime d'histoire. And I'm saying chronotope, and as most of you know in the Ukraine, I'm borrowing the signifier, not the meaning, from Bakhtin. Now, when Bakhtin talks about the chronotope, he's fascinated by an entanglement between time, chronos, and space, topos. I'm using the word chronotope in a much more simple meaning. I mean by chronotope nothing but social construction of temporality. Social construction of temporality implying that the social construction of temporality is subject to historical change. And I'm using this concept of the chronotope in a totalizing way. I think that, I mean, normally one is not allowed to do totalization, but I like totalizations, must be because I was born in Germany. This was a moment where you're supposed to laugh, but you didn't. Thank you. why do I think that the chronotope, social construction of temporality, is a good way of totalizing? Because I believe that Husserl, the philosopher Husserl, was right when he said, proposing a definition of time, what we call time is the form of experience. So if we presuppose that the regime of time, the social construction of time, changes historically, then these changes impact every single experience that we are making. So according to the ways that we relate the past to the present to the future, and we do that in historical different ways, this will impact, this will change every single experience. So I think there's something very central at stake when we talk about transformations of the chronotope. Now, in the interviews I did today, and I was astonished that so many people wanted to talk to me, but I felt very flattered, the question was always asked, how can you explain the change of chronotopes? So if you believe that what we used to call historical time is no longer our central time, why is this the case? And after trying for a long time to give an answer, I've given up on it. Because all the answers I can give, so why did the historical chronotope vanish, are very general answers. You say, oh, because of globalization, or because of a growing complexity of our everyday. And that is like giving no answer. I mean, these are dummy symbols instead of giving answers. So I try to describe the change of chronotopes, but I deliberately do not try to give you an answer. I think anyway, this is not something we can change. This is something that happens to us and we have to take it. I mean, an old-fashioned word would be, but I like old-fashioned words, the change of chronotopes is fate and we cannot do anything about it. So we cannot stop, we cannot say, oh, let's revitalize the historical chronotope. It will not happen. Okay, so Do you feel at this point you have an impression of what's at stake in this lecture and what this lecture is all about? Now, very late in the game, I give you what my Californian students with a computer metaphor call the menu lecture. What follows will have four parts. I will talk in the first part, and some of you know that already, I apologize. I will give you a brief sketch of the emergence of the historicist chronotope, of what we used to call historical time and naturalized. We believe that's the only time, and this is a story that starts in the late 18th century. Now, the starting point for the emergence of the historicist chronotope is the moment when, in the late 18th century, in a small social group, the first order observer, the observer of the world, the subject, as we call it, became habitually self-reflexive. This is a moment when the observer first order became a second order observer, namely somebody who inevitably had to observe herself or himself in the act of world observation. And this happened within a small group at the end of the 18th century, the group who then called themselves les philosophes, and this is basically what we call today the intellectuals. And that is still true for intellectuals. What makes intellectuals so strange, so weird for the rest of the population, is that they cannot help observing themselves in the act of self-observation. Is that clear so far?
No.
Yeah. But it's weird, isn't it? I mean, we are proud of it, but for normal people, and I wish I could be a normal person, that's very weird. I mean, I cannot stop doing it. Now, this brings immediately up two problems, and people talk about these problems in the late 18th century. Somebody who habitually observes himself in the act of world observation realizes that the result of his world observation, the knowledge that he or she produces, depends on his point of view. And as they know that there is potentially an infinity of point of views, you could say, for each object of reference, there is potentially an infinity of representations. And this creates, in the late 18th century, really an existential problem, something like an epistemological horror vacui. And people think, if there is a potential infinity of representation for each object of reference, can there be a self-identical object of reference? Is that clear? The second problem, there's a famous German classical author, Heinrich von Kleist, who was not a great philosopher, fantastic author, and he read only a couple of pages of Kant and became aware of what he calls perspectivism, that would be perspectivism. And he was on the verge of committing suicide. I mean, 14 years later, he committed suicide anyway. I said he will never read Kant again because this is so shocking, so this was a real existential problem. The second problem is that a second order observer rediscovers, counter to the Cartesian observer, counter to the subject, that there are two levels of world appropriation. There's world appropriation by concepts, what we normally call experience, but there's also world appropriation by the senses, world appropriation by the body, what we can call perception. And the question was, is there a compatibility between world appropriation by concepts, experience, and world appropriation by the senses, perception? Now, the miraculous thing is to observe that within a very short time, both these problems found solutions. The second problem found a brutal solution, namely it was bracketed. You can observe that this problem that the late 18th century called materialism, how does sensual perception relate to experience, was just bracketed. You would not speak about that. And when Marx, for example, talks about materialism, that's a completely different thing. Yeah, and Marx mentions the senses from time to time, but perception doesn't play a role in Hegel, doesn't play a role in Marx. The second problem, however, the problem of perspectivism, infinity of representation for each object of reference, found a smashingly successful solution. And this solution was to switch epistemologically from a mirror-like type of world representation. You need one description for each object of reference. That would be the encyclopedia, for example, to a narrative world representation. You can observe that from the early 19th century on, when somebody is asked, what is Ukraine or what is Kyiv, You have to tell the history of Kyiv. And from a little bit later on, under the influence of Darwin, if somebody was asked, what is a camel or what is a horse, you have to tell the evolutionary history of the horse. And if somebody is the young Hegel and asks himself, what is the spirit, then he will end up writing the phenomenology of the spirit, which for those of you who have read it know, it's a narrative. Get the point. Now, why is a narrative a solution? I mean, people didn't think about it this way. That's my reconstruction. I think it is a solution because the paradigm of the narrative allows to neutralize, to include different representations. Yeah? In a narrative, for example, imagine the narrative of an animal, for example. You can include different views, different stages of this animal. Get my point? So this is in the early 19th century that the problem of perspectivism seems to be taken care of by this switch to a narrative paradigm. Now, this is the basis, this, and Michel Foucault in Les Mots et les Choses calls that historisation des êtres, historicization of beings. This historicization of beings is a solution on which the historical worldview will emerge. Now, let me very briefly describe historically the historical worldview. It is that worldview in which at first we believe that we always leave the past behind ourselves and that the impact of the past, the orientational value of the past, is fading the further the past recedes into a distance. Yeah? I mean, something from 5,000 years ago is less useful to understand the present and the future than something from 5 years ago. Is that clear? Secondly, and you will say, well, that's history in it by itself, but I want to historicize that. This did not exist before 1780 or so. Secondly, the historicist worldview is a worldview in which the future appears as an open horizon of possibilities from which we can choose. That would be the precondition of politics. Thirdly, in the historicist worldview, between that past that recedes and this future, which is an open horizon of possibility, the present is perceived, and I quote Charles Baudelaire, the poet from 1858, Painter of Modern Life, the past, the present, is shrinking to be an imperceptibly short moment of transition. In the historical worldview, the present, so to speak, has no substance. The present is a fraction of a second. Fourthly, and this is, I think, the most important feature, and this is what you could identify philosophically with metaphysics, this present, this imperceptibly short present, becomes the place, the epistemological habitat of the subject, of consciousness, of the Cartesian self-reference. In the historical worldview, you believe that based on experience from the past, in the present, you can choose among the possibilities of the future. Yeah, and this is what, since the early 19th century, we call action, what we call Handlung. And this is what, within the historicist worldview, we believe distinguishes humans from other beings. Is that clear? So based on experience from the past, you can choose among the possibilities of the future, but the instance that chooses is consciousness, excludes the body, is barely consciousness. Is that clear? Finally, in the historicist worldview, we believe that time is a necessary agent of change, that there are no phenomena that can escape transformation in time. It may happen faster, it may happen more slowly, but there will always be transformation, and therefore, there will always subsequently be a new open future. Yeah? Now, this worldview, by, let's say, 1830, in what we call then Europe, what we call the Western world, and I think now we can call it the global world, becomes so firmly institutionalized that people believe this is time in and by itself. Yeah? This is what I call the naturalization of the historical chronotype. People believe that's time, and this is why it's so difficult for us to say, well, we are no longer living in this chronotype. This chronotope is the precondition for philosophy of history. There is no Hegel, no Hegelian thinking, there is no Marx without this chronotope. But it is also the precondition for evolutionism in the sciences. There is no Darwin without that chromatogram. It is the precondition for socialism, early socialism, Marxist socialism. There is no socialism without that construction of time. But it is also a precondition for practice capitalism. There is no capitalism. You need open future and certain experience from the past for capitalism in the sense of the. And if you see that there's hardly anything that matters in the 19th and early 20th century that does not depend on this chronotope, and that explains why it became so naturalized. So, do you feel you've all understood that? Then you can unfasten the seatbelts a little bit. That was already the worst part of the lecture. If you have survived that standing, I'll be very proud. Maybe I had to get up so I can accompany you. Okay, so this is the first part. This is the emergence of the historicist chronotope, and we leave it where it's very heavily institutionalized. Let me add that it is precisely this chronotope that invents the concept of enlightenment. Yeah? When we say enlightenment, what we really imply is this is the prehistory of the worldview that became obligatory, institutionalized, canonical during the 19th and a large part of the 20th century. Yeah, so that made the 18th century into enlightenment. There is no enlightenment without a retrospective from the historical worldview. It's a narrative retrospective because it's what we believe now had a prehistory, and the prehistory that prepared that was the 18th century. The second part I want to spare you because that's the book I'm writing about, and I want you to be curious what the book will be. That book will be about what my students, but it's actually a student from Russia who called it metaphorically the underbelly of enlightenment, with a very heavy Russian accent, and that fits well, the underbelly of enlightenment. Now, there are certain important intellectuals in the 18th century who do not participate in this worldview. They are neither marginalized nor repressed, but there is another possibility of perceiving the world. And I want to briefly mention it because I think this different possibility of perceiving the world and of time has an affinity with the different chronotope in which we are living today. Now, some of these people I'm referring to are Denis Diderot, above all, the French philosopher Diderot. The book is mainly about him. But also the painter, the creative artist, Francisco de Goya, the German philosopher of nature, Lichtenberg, and the most popular among them, I think Mozart is an absolute example of that. I will not go into any detail. The point would be that in this other worldview, in this underbelly of enlightenment, the polyperspectivism is not reduced. Polyperspectivism is not reduced. The world appears as a field of contingency. I mean, each object of reference has a multiplicity of interpretations, and you have to choose in each case. You don't choose the future, you choose your interpretation. And that means that judgment becomes very central. Yeah? This underbelly of enlightenment is associated with judgment. And this may be the reason why Diderot became the inventor of modern art criticism. So Diderot always talks about individual paintings, yeah, in this very early salon exhibitions, annual exhibitions in Paris, and then he makes one judgment per painting. And he never implies that other people have to participate. You have to make a judgment. Is this a good painting? Is that a bad painting? Secondly, in this other worldview, the problem of whether world appropriation through the senses is compatible with world appropriation through the concepts is not bracketed. The problem is there. And this is what one can call Diderot's materialism. Yeah? Diderot was, and these people were obsessed with the sensual appropriation of the world. And Diderot wrote two texts, the letter on the blind and the letter on the deaf, to imagine what the worldview of a deaf person would be. What the worldview of a blind person would be. So this materialism stays there and becomes very, very important, which goes with a different concreteness of the world. The concreteness of the world is very important, very central in this worldview. But I will not go any further, so wait for that book. I hope I finish it this coming summer. I'm tempted to give it the title, although it's a dirty title, it's an unacademic title, but it would be a beautiful title. The Underbelly of Enlightenment, Diderot, Goya, Lichtenberg, Mozart. And people think, why is Mozart the underbelly of enlightenment? Mm-hmm. It is actually, as a footnote, it is interesting that all these people, except Diderot, had some corporeal problem. Lichtenberg was a dwarf. Lichtenberg was shorter than 1 meter. Mozart was almost a dwarf. Mozart had his Tourette syndrome. Mozart had to say obscene things expulsively all the time. And Goya was deaf. And this is another interesting detail for this underbelly of enlightenment. This is a philosophical position which you find from time to time in the 19th and in the 20th century. I think it fits Nietzsche, for example. Nietzsche is absolutely not participating in the historicist worldview. Nietzsche talks about the eternal return. That would not be allowed within the historical worldview. Nietzsche talks about the surface, about sensuality. I think in a different way, this is also true for a great admirer of Nietzsche, and that is Heidegger. Heidegger's, what Heidegger calls the history of being, has absolutely nothing to do with historicism. But I bracket this and I come to already, so you're more than halfway through, the third part of my lecture. And this is about the crisis of the historical worldview in the mid-20th century. Now we jump 150 years, mid-20th century. I think the first symptoms of the crisis of the historical worldview are in the mid-20th century. I get the impression you're still interested, you're still bearing with me. I shouldn't skip, okay. Now this refers to that book that is forthcoming in Russian and in Polish now. And I give you a very short impression. The impression was, and I'm quoting from intellectual, I'm quoting Albert Camus in this point from 1951. The question was that all of a sudden that flow of history, that development of history, this history of progress that people had been feeling, on the left or on the right, the Nazis felt that too. The Nazis too felt that history is flowing, will go somewhere. That all of a sudden, after World War II, that flowing got congested. Congested is a metaphor that Camus is using obsessively. And they thought this had to do with World War II. World War II was not well digested. But let me briefly describe, to illustrate this situation, this crisis situation, mid-20th century, so we're talking late 40s, early 50s, the time when I was born on June 15, 1948, I was born into this situation, what congestion meant. There is, for example, an obsession among Western intellectuals with the topic of no exit, no entry. So, and if you cannot exit, neither exit nor enter, if you cannot cross a threshold, you can make no progress. That clear? If you cannot cross the threshold, you make no progress. So the most famous example, most of you will know that, is the most famous drama of Jean-Paul Sartre, Huis Clos, behind closed doors. Yeah? Three people locked into a room, but then all of a sudden the door opens and they realize they cannot leave the room, even with an open door. Who among you knows the film by Luis Buñuel, El Ángel Exterminador? You know that? So Kyiv wins against Warsaw. Nobody knew it yesterday in Warsaw. This is a party of high society people in Mexico City, also produced in the early 1950s. So they hang out, they get all drunk, they have a lot of sex, and then they want to go home, and all of a sudden they cannot walk through the door. And then they're 3 days locked into that luxury villa, all exhausted, and then typical Buñuel, surrealist motif, all of a sudden a flock of sheep passes by, and once the sheep pass by, they can all leave. But you get, I mean, and there are literally hundreds of examples as an obsession. Other obsession, you can also not enter. I give you the most famous German example. This is a very popular, not a very good, but a very popular drama in the German, was this a question?
The name of the movie.
El Ángel Exterminador, the exterminating angel. It's worthwhile, isn't it a fantastic movie? It's very, very impressive. It's one of the better movies of Buñuel. Okay, the other example I wanted to give you, I mean, No Entry, is a drama by a young German who died shortly after the first production of the drama in 1947, Wolfgang Borchardt. Title is Draußen vor der Tür, outside, in front of a closed door. Now, this is a participant in World War, it's very autobiographical, World War II, the Private Beckmann, who returns to his home city, Hamburg, and goes to his house and finds his bed next to his wife occupied by another man, obviously. I mean, like so many German people who came back from the Eastern Front. Maybe they deserved that. but don't quote me on that in Germany. Secondly, then he goes to the house of his parents. The house is demolished by bombs, and he also learns that his parents had committed suicides because they were Nazis. And then he decides to commit suicide in his home city of Hamburg, and he throws himself into the river Elbe in Hamburg, and this is a bad drama, then the river spits him out. Yeah, it's not a good drama, but you get the point, this obsession, you cannot enter. Now that means congestion, you cannot cross a threshold. A second motif of congestion that I wanted to explain to you briefly is the motif of bad faith and interrogation. Now bad faith, mauvaise foi, is one of the great philosophical discoveries of the 20th century. It starts in Freud, and I think the one who describes it the best is Jean-Paul Sartre in the second chapter of his book, Lettre le Néant, Being and Nothingness, where he says, to have full transparency of one's own consciousness is impossible. You never have full transparency, and as you never have full transparency, you can never be fully authentic. But paradoxically, you also can never fully lie. Yeah, every intentional lie implies a truth. And that motif is also obsessive in the late 40s, early 50s, drives people crazy, and I think it motivates an obsession with interrogations. You have to invent empirical methods to find out what's going on in people's mind. And the most obsessive example that I know is a book that was published the day I was born. I'm kind of proud of that, and that is the Kinsey Report. Who knows what the Kinsey Report was? Some people. Well, the Kinsey Report was an empirical research on the sexuality of Americans. Yeah, you may have seen the film with Liam Neeson, Kinsey. It's a very, very good historical reconstruction. This was a professor in Indiana who had to teach an introductory course to his young students on sex. I mean, basically in America, that means have never sex. But he felt he has to be more responsible, he has to know more about sexual practice, and he starts doing interviews. And he does many, many, 10,000 interviews. But the interesting thing about this book is that the book is about 1,000 pages, 400 pages are about methodology. So how can you do an empirical investigation that you can really be certain that people don't lie to you, that people really tell you the truth? Another great example, with which you are endlessly more familiar, I guess, is the young Pier Paolo Pasolini, the film director, who started out as a young poet, and he was the first more or less openly gay homosexual poet, probably in Europe, definitely in Italy. So he talks about a similar motif. He was a Marxist. He said, yes, this Italy after 1945 is much better than the Mussolini Italy, but it does not include the liberation of homosexuals, for example. It's not the only motif. So there's also this derailment. And this derailment makes people enormously nervous. And I think it explains why there is an obsession to be protected against this insecurity, to protect yourself in a container, in a shell. The most obsessive poet in this sense is maybe the greatest lyrical poet of German language, he was not German, in the 20th century, Paul Celan, and his most famous poem is Todesfugel, Fugue of Death. When every stanza, there's a very drastic description of a threat to Jews in Germany, yes? German shepherds, these dogs, biting them, chasing them. And then the end of each stanza, the refrain, is always dreaming of a bed in heaven. A bed in heaven would be such a container where you would be protected. But you see again this dynamic between derailment and container is not history flowing. Get my point? So there's this feeling of congestion that we associate, did my generation associate it with World War II? And I'm saying my generation because I consider myself to be 68 generation, students' revolution generation. And we wanted, this was the motivation, we wanted to get history afloat again. So we wanted to confront the parents' generation, tell us everything about Nazism, not only in Germany, it was the same in France, the same in America, this confrontation. And we thought if we know that, then finally history will get going again. Now, as you all know, it didn't happen. And that explains the phenomena of terrorism, of the Red Army fraction in Germany, for example. People who said 68 was not tough enough, We have to physically explode the society. We have to open it up so that progress will happen again. Now the interesting thing is that we always thought this only happened in countries that participated in World War II, but I integrated into my book Brazil as a test case. I mean, Brazil officially participated with the Allies in World War II, but there was no considerable action. There's a big monument in Rio in honor of the participants, Brazilian participants in World War II, but it was 500, and they all came late for the American reconquest of Italy. So, but Brazil has the same feeling of congestion, and that proves it has nothing to do with World War II. You get my point? So 68 was the attempt to get history afloat. Now, the real crisis year, I think, is a later year, intellectually speaking, and this is 1973. 1973 is the year in which a book whose title most of you will know appeared by Jean-François Lyotard, whom I consider to be a very important philosopher. This book is not a great book, but it's symptomatologically interesting. And this is La Condition Postmoderne. Now, what La Condition Postmoderne really is a critique of what he calls les grands récits. In English, the master narratives. And the argument is that by absorbing the problem of perspectivism in one grand narrative, un grand récit, a master narrative, you have no solution, because of course it is possible for each given event and situation to tell an infinity of narratives. So historicism is not a solution of the problem of perspectivism. Is that clear? So this is a crisis symptom, and randomly and interestingly, in the same year, the book of my former Stanford colleague Hayden White appeared, Meta-History. Yeah, Meta-History was an encouragement to consider history writing not as referential, but as a type of literature. For each event, you can write many different representations in many different tones, in many different genres. So the mood of the time was heterotopology. Multiplicity of histories, postmodern history, write the history that you find convenient. Yeah? So this is the postmodern mood. What we call postmodernity in retrospect, I think, is a very strong crisis symptom of the historicist chronotope, but it is not yet a new chronotope. Because I think here is what did not really function with the postmodernity, I mean plurality, selection, eclecticism, and so forth, and so forth. In the first place, the postmodern was not really another historical period within historicism, within a historical sequence. I think what the postmodern announced was a different chronotope, a different régime d'histoire, I mean, a different way of connecting the past, the present, and the future. But this is what people did not understand. Secondly, I think that the solution of heterotopology, write many histories, that was experienced like a liberation at the beginning, turned out, that's at least my experience, to be banal in the long run. Yeah? I mean, they say, okay, you can't tell any story well, so fine, everybody has his or her own story that will lead nowhere. I mean, for example, the book that you were kind enough to mention is in 1926 has been misunderstood as being neo-historicist. No, it's the opposite. I mean, in full awareness that nobody can write the objective history, I want each, this is a book with very many small chapters, 55 small chapters, I want each description to be as close to objective as possible. I mean, I describe, for example, elevators in the 1920s, these Paternoster elevators. And I want to describe them in a way that is close to objective. I mean, this is not a story. This book is absolutely not a story. It's 55 snapshots, 55 short descriptions. Okay, so I sit down again because now we're going into, you have been patient for 45 minutes. How about 12 minutes and 30 seconds more. Gonna make that. And I will sit for this 12 minutes and 40 seconds more. And I'll see where I am with my notes. I forgot to look into my notes. That's really bad. But or maybe it was actually good not to look into my notes. Oh yeah, let me give, there's one thing that I will say in standing. That's interesting. One last thing that postmodernism did not take into account was that I think this whole mood came with a different self-reference. Remember, the human self-reference within the historicist chronotope is the subject. That there is a desire for a different self-reference. Humans conceiving of themselves not as consciousness. And one example that I love is American abstract expressionism and my probably favorite painter of all times, Jackson Pollock. Now, Jackson Pollock gave in his entire life two interviews, and he was definitely not a philosopher, but they are philosophically interesting. They say, so what are you doing? All of a sudden, Jackson Pollock is sensational. Peggy Guggenheim loves him, sleeps with him. Pictures sell for hundreds of thousands of dollars, which was a lot of money then, and they interview him. They said, what are you doing? He said, I'm doing nothing, I'm just dripping. Yeah? I'm just dripping, so it's a body. I mean, he's no mind, how do you plan? Oh, no, I just drip. I just go there and drip the... He never says the color, it's also interesting. I drip the paint. Yeah? And then they secondly ask him, so how do you work on the canvas? And I said, above all, I do not stand in front of the canvas. It's not me, the subject, and there, the object, the painting. I'm in the canvas. And you know, Jackson Pollock had his canvases lying on the floor, and he was going with this bucket with paint and was dripping. Yeah? So he is in the painting. It's not a subject-object relationship. And I said, how do you know whether your painting is good? And I said, he says, well, I observe whether a painting emerges or not. You get the point? The agency is not his. The agency is of the painting. You get my point? This is a completely different self. I mean, it is as far away from the Cartesian subject as you can possibly think, and it requires a body. So you want a body as self-reference. Okay. Now, I want to stand. I don't want to speculate about the reasons. I mean, so far I've described the emergence and the structure of the old chronotope. And so far, I have only described crisis systems of the old chronotype. To use a current American word, you could feel around 1950 that something was cracking, something was not working. And of course, what my generation did, and this is why it is a kind of lost generation, a tragic or comical generation, we spent our entire life trying to get the historicist chronotype afloat again. We wanted history to flow again, and it turned out more and more and more impossible. And it drove some people of my generation crazy. I mean, this is the RAF, this is Bader Meinhof. I happen to know Ulrike Meinhof. She was, it's not what you imagine, a terrorist. She was desperate. She felt that change and progress has to happen again. And she ended up being, I mean, you know, this kind of trying to get it going again. And then there are these crisis symptoms. And now, the fourth part, and I think without sitting down, I will try to describe you what I believe is the chronotope in which we are living now. I haven't described that yet. I only have described crisis symptoms. Clear? Okay, so I call this other chronotope, the chronotope of the broad present. It's not a very good name. I have no better name. There is a short book that exists in English at Columbia University Press, in German and in Spanish. That's called Our Broad Present. But I mean, you don't have to read that book. What I believe is that this is the chronotope in which most of us, again globally, live our everyday. I mean, this is the way we see the future, the past, and the present in the morning when we wake up before brushing teeth and reminding that we have to think historically. Okay, so that's pre-teeth brushing chronotope. If you brush your teeth. If you don't, you stay in that chronotope all day. Okay, so in the first place, I think that in that chronotope of the broad present, the future is not an open horizon of possibilities, but the future is occupied by threats that come towards us. And by threats that come towards us inevitably. Think of global warming, think of the exhaustion of resources, think of the demographic development. We believe that if we behave well, we may slow that down. So global warming, the inundation of the world may come later, but it will come. Now, I'm not making a claim that people who think that are right. I'm not making this claim because I hope they're wrong. And I'm also an ecological pig, so I'm not very, but this is on people's mind. I mean, the future is something threatening. The future is definitely not a beautiful open horizon of possibilities you want to choose. Think of those politicians. They feel that there's always a crisis. I'm not saying there are objectively more crises than in the past. I'm just saying this is the way we see the future. Is that clear? Yeah. Secondly, I believe that the past for us today is no longer something that we leave behind and that is vanishing in our back. I think that pastness and the past today, partly thanks to electronic storage possibilities, is an aggressive past. It is a past that is inundating the present. Yeah? I mean, it will shortly be possible to have every document that exists on the planet available on every laptop screen. And it's no longer a technological problem, it's barely a juridical problem. I mean, it's a copyright problem. Yeah, imagine that. I mean, under these conditions, nobody will be able to write a dissertation in the humanities. Because you're obliged, by definition, for a doctoral dissertation to have read all the materials that are relevant. Now, if all materials are available, you can never finish. It would take you 27 lifetimes to finish the tiniest topic. Yeah, I mean, that's what I mean. We are inundated by the past. Let me give you one other example. This obsession with memorial years. Yeah? Every year, every day is a memorial year. This year, for example, my favorite German daily newspaper, the Frankfurter Allgemeine, they were commemorating 1914, beginning of World War I, and every day you had footage, you had a film from that war. Yeah, that's interesting, but you get my point, we are inundated by the past. Thirdly, and that's my most important point, between that future that appears to be blocked and that past that is inundating us instead of vanishing, the present is no longer an imperceptibly short moment of transition. I think our everyday present is a broadening present of simultaneities. So everything is present in our present. Everything is there in our present. So this present is a little bit like the worldview of this underbelly vision. It's contingency. You always have too many things. You are confronted with an oversupply. This makes you nervous. You get the point? So this is not an imperceptibly short moment of transition. Fourth point, and that may be the most important one. Remember, in the historicist chronotope, there was a connection between this imperceptibly short present and the Cartesian self-reference, the self-reference as subject, as pure consciousness. Now, if we live in a different present today, structurally different present, that would explain why for the past decades we have been so eager to recuperate the physical side of our life, to recuperate the body, as people are saying, to recuperate the soma, to recuperate the senses. In philosophy, yeah, there are huge attempts to have a different type of self-reference. Neurophilosophy, one of the more visible and also a little bit ridiculous symptoms of that, I mean, to try to combine neuroscience and philosophy, but it comes from there. But also in our everyday. I mean, who has never dieted? Who has never jogged? I have never dieted, nor never jogged, but I must be the only one, at least in California. We are crazily concerned about the body, and if we're not crazily concerned about our body, I'm not. Then we are crazy couch potatoes. We have to watch sports all the time. You get my point? So the self-reference in the historical chronotope is a self-reference that emphatically includes the body. Final point. I think in the chronotope of the broad present, we do not consider time to be a necessary agent of change anymore. Yeah, it is possible that certain things come back, or that certain things do not change. Instead of talking about American creationism, which is such a conviction, which is very embarrassing for an American citizen to talk about, if you know what I'm referring to, I will refer to a rebirth of a motif of Nietzsche. So when I was a student of philosophy 40 years ago, when a professor was teaching Nietzsche, said, well, there is one motif in Nietzsche that is embarrassing and that is crazy and we don't want to talk about that, and that is the eternal return. Yeah, that Nietzsche speaks about things coming back without changing all the time. I think I'm not exaggerating much if I'm saying that in today Nietzsche's reading, the eternal return is the most popular, the most fascinating topic. So, I mean, these things like things coming back obsessively, also reiteration, the Freudian sense, that fascinates us. Is that clear? So this would be, I pretend, this is the chronotope in which we are spending our everyday, definitely before toothbrushing, probably even after toothbrushing. I mean, if we don't want to be historians. Now, second remark, and that's an important one, I think. It's a paradoxical one. It is in the logic of that chronotope that cannot leave anything behind. Yeah? Everything gets stored in the present. This is why it's a present of simultaneities. That it does also not leave behind the old chronotope. Get the point? The old historicist chronotope is part, is inside the new chronotope. And that means that there are, as we say in American English, pockets in our societies where we still live in the old chronotope. If you are in a history department and want to get a master or a PhD in history, you better be in the historicist chronotope. And if not, your professor will tell you that you don't understand what history is and will not give you a PhD. If you are a politician and running a campaign, you have to act as if you believe that the future is open, you can shape it. Yeah? If not, you cannot run an election campaign, although everybody knows that the Social Democrats will not change the German future, really. Well, everybody knows at least that nobody can prognosticate the future. And nevertheless, this language, this discourse is continued. Is that clear? So this is very important. It's a second condition. So the first condition of the present situation was this description of the chronotope of the broad present. The second condition was to say that the broad chronotope, the broad present includes the old chronotope. The old chronotope is not gone, it is still around. And this is why people say, no, history has not come to an end. We are still living. No, you can always refer to it. Some people believe in it, and it's perfectly okay to believe in it. I'm not saying these are bad people. But I think that the quantitatively, phenomenologically predominant chronotope is the chronotope of the broad present. Now, if we say that this means that we have a parallelism, we have the dominant chronotope of the broad present, but the other one is still around, I think this happens also in our present-day culture in terms of self-reference. So we have on the one side, and I was already saying that, these attempts to recuperate the body, to recuperate the soma, to recuperate the senses, to jogging and so forth. And sports has never been as practice sport and spectator sport, remotely as popular as today. You may find that a bad thing, I find that it's a good thing, but it's a quantitative fact. But this is not the only self-reference. At the same time, for most people today in the global world, the typical working situation, even for formerly proletarian professions, is a situation where you spend at least 8 hours per day in front of a computer screen. And that is a situation that you can describe as a fusion of consciousness and software. A situation in which your body is completely superfluous, you don't need a body. So get my point, I'm saying today we are at the same time more Cartesian than ever. And while we are more Cartesian than ever, we also try to recuperate the body. Fourth point. In this situation today, I think that what used to be a field of contingency, so the world appears as a field of things that have different representations, but that is limited. It is surrounded on the one side by what is necessary, certain things we consider necessary, and on the other side by things that we think are impossible. That's what you call a field of contingency, a field because it is limited. But I think we find ourselves today in an existential situation where what was a field of contingency and of randomness becomes a universe of randomness. Because I think on the one side, what we consider to be necessary is being diluted. Let me give you an example. Traditionally, people considered the sex into which they were born as necessary, as fate. You couldn't like the sex, but you were born as a woman, or you were born as a man, and that was it, or you were born as a hermaphrodite. Today, when that happens to you and you have enough money, you do transsexual surgery. So there is nothing necessary anymore, nothing considered. I'm not saying that's bad, it's just a difference. On the other side, I think that everything that we used to consider as impossible is now becoming degraded into a possibility. The best example being immortality. Immortality used to be the one grand example of something impossible. And you may know that today to think about physical immortality has become a serious topic within medical research. Whether it will ever happen or not is not the question. But the fact that what used to be the absolute impossible now becomes something possible, something thinkable. And I believe that this situation where we live in a universe of contingency, in a universe of contingency, is a continuous existential overload. I mean, you could say it's a gain of liberty, a gain of freedom, but you have to choose in every situation. You have to choose in every situation, and this is probably more than we can take. I think this explains, for example, the burnout syndromes today. And objectively, most people are spending less hours working today than they used to spend in the past. But then they have to spend 2 days per week to organize the weekend. And if you have 10,000 possibilities to spend the weekend, only electronically, of course it becomes terribly stressful to choose. And this explains, and this is my last point in this description, why I think something has been attractive, existentially attractive today, that I would like to call, using a classical theological metaphor, the early church described itself as Christ's mystical body. And that meant that the members of the Christian church, the members of the church, were not only spiritually united. When you talk about a class, for example, social class, class solidarity, something spiritual, even proletarian solidarity. But the mystical body is a physical co-presence. And I think mystical bodies have become absolutely central, have become an object of fascination and appeal in our present-day cultures. Let me give you three examples. So I start with something religious. We know today that whenever the Pope, for example, appears to read an open-air mass, wherever that is, even in countries with very few Christians, a million people will appear. And we know that even in the Christian countries, 50% of those million don't even know what a mass is or what the Pope is. But they like to be together, physically together in the open space. The second example that I want to quote is sports indeed. I mean, when broadcasting on TV first started, the German Soccer Federation prohibited it because it said it will make the stadiums empty. Yeah, today, I don't know about the Ukrainian Soccer League, but in most countries of the world, certainly in Central Europe, certainly in the US, stadiums are fuller than ever. And we know public viewing since the last World Cup is terribly popular. We know that people who go to a public viewing, more than half of them do not go there to watch the game. They love to go there because they love to be part of one body, of 1 million bodies, in front of the Brandenburg Gate in Berlin. And then they may cheer when the German team appears, but that is not important. These are not only soccer fans. And that, I think, has a certain articulation, and I don't want to delegitimize it, with something like Maidan, and with something like the Arabic Spring. And with something like the protest in Brazil, and this brings me, and now you are really on the final stretch, two more minutes, to some final questions. You get my point? The question for discussion would be, but I'm not an expert, if this broad present with all its consequences, as I have been trying to describe it, is the predominant existential situation in which we are living, the predominant chronotope, then we have to seriously and creatively, if possible, think about a different type of politics. I think parliamentary politics, the way we know it, cannot be the solution, although, of course, I'm aware that it is dangerous to give up parliamentary politics.